צהריים טובים, אנחנו ממשיכים בתוכנית ובבוקר שמענו הרצאה של אסטרונאוט. עכשיו אנחנו נקיים רב שיח בהשתתפות שלוש אסטרונאוטיות ממקומות שונים, עם תרבויות שונות ופעילות מאוד מגוונת בחלל של המדינות מהן האסטרונאוטיות מגיעות. וכל אחת מהן מאחזת בקורות חיים המשמעותיים ביותר. מכיוון שהזמן שלנו הוא קצת מצומצם, אז אני אקצר. האסטרונאוטית השנה שאני מבקש לעלות לדברה היא סמנטיקה קריסטופלטי מסוכנות החלל האיטלקית וסוכנות החלל האירופאית. בין שאר תפקידיה שקדמו להיותה טייסת חלל, היא בוגרת האקדמיה של חיל האוויר האיטלקית, טייסת של מספר דמים של נושאי תקיפה, כנראה להיזהר ולא לשאול שאלות מאוד נכונות, והיא מהנדסת, למדה בין השאר לתואר שני באוניברסיטה הטכנית במינכן, והשתתפה בטיסת חלל שאליה היא שורה באמצעות החללית סויוז, והייתה בתחנת החלל הבינלאומית כמעט 200 ימים. So I will ask to the stand, to the stage, Samantha Cristoforetti, please.
And the second astronaut that I will ask to the stage is astronaut Shannon Walker. שלום בוקר, היא בעלת תואר דוקטור ועבדה במשך הרבה שנים במרכז הבקרה של טיסות החלל המאוישות. שם פיקחה והייתה בקשר עם הרבה מאוד משימות של מעבורת החלל עם ובלי ממצאים לתחנת החלל הבינלאומי. הייתה בחלל 163 ימים בסך הכל, מתוכם יומיים בסיוז והיתר בתחנת החלל הבינלאומית. שם היא ביצעה בין יתר התפקידים מספר פעילויות מחוץ לחללית, מה שאנחנו מכנים EVA. The third participant at this special panel is Yi Soo-yong from Korea. האסטרונאוטית היחידה בינתיים של קוריאה, מן הסתם אנחנו נשמע עוד על הפעילויות השונות של המדינה הזאת בתחום החלל. היא השתתפה במשימת החלל שלה בשנת 2008 ועלתה לחלל באמצעות החללית סויוז הרוסית, שם גם ברוסיה עברה את ההכשרה שלה כאסטרונאוטית. במסגרת השהייה שלה בתחנת החלל, ביצעה מספר גדול של ניסויים מדעיים בתחומים מגוונים, כולל בתחומים של ביולוגיה עבור סוכנות החלל הקוריאנית. אני רוצה לעבור לשם.
אנחנו נמשיך.
First of all, I have to apologize for not being a woman. I will work hard towards the next conference. So this is a semi-open conversation between three astronauts with vast experience and from different countries and cultures. And I asked my friends on Twitter and Facebook earlier on today to post their questions also. So the first one, which personally I don't like because I don't want to emphasize the difference between a woman and a man, but this is the question from the audience. So how it is to be a woman astronaut first in North Korea, then Italy, Europe, and United States, which has a lot of women astronauts. since the late 1980s, really. So, please.
There is a little difference between it because we are different humankind. We cannot deny it. Of course, we are different. And I have a question from Israeli kids several days ago. Ask about female astronaut, how can you handle your long hair? Because most of our male astronaut has a short hair. Of course, in normal life, some guys have long hair, some woman has a short hair, but generally, woman has a long hair. And I told her, I seriously considered to cut my hair because it's a little uncomfortable when we had to close our helmet, because sometimes my hair is older and we don't have air tightening. And my instructor told me, please check your helmet again. And I feel so sorry to delay the training without the male astronaut. So I considered to cut it. But one of my close friend, Katie Coleman, I went to her, Katie, how do you think if I cut my hair? And she strongly told me, please don't. It's a huge privilege as a woman astronaut because if he will go to space, and then they only have a portrait photo. Nobody knows if he's space or not, because hair is vain. But a woman, you just untie your hair, everybody recognizes you are in space. It's a huge privilege. And you are the first international, so a lot of kids wondering about your hair and what's, you know, the geography, how you move, and what's the difference, but you don't have to say anything, just untie your hair. That tells everybody you are in the space. So I think that was a good part to hear a woman astronaut, even if there's a lot of other things there.
Well, Samantha, you don't have a lot of problem with your hair.
Yeah, that's an interesting perspective. Yeah, no, it's a question that we get a lot, to be honest, and it's like asking you, how is it to be a man?
I feel more familiar with English than Russian, and actually, find the same candidate, we will have one professional and we will train all other guys. So, but at first, it was hard, but I took a while. Everybody's saying hashtag, so it's not really easy.
Another question for you. NASA has a long tradition of space flights, and so is Italy and the European Space Agency in general. Man. You were the first astronaut from Korea. So, first of all, what was the feeling to represent Korea for the first time in space, and what was the reaction in Korea? And I have to mention that I was in Korea in 2009, so many statues. Throughout the city of Daejeon, there was the International Astronomical Conference then. So I believe something like the Garden may have experience, but we would like to hear from you.
Actually, you always have a good side and bad side, and comfortable side and uncomfortable side always. I feel so honored to be the first grand astronaut. I think it's a huge privilege not only to be an astronaut, but also to be the first. So, everybody looking at me. And of course, I became so famous, but at the same time, I feel so stressful because every single motion, every single action, kind of criticized by some person, judged by some person. And as in Asian culture, being a woman is also sometimes really huge thing to handle it, because somebody just want to say usually because a woman shouldn't make a mistake, we shouldn't make guys. But I don't think it's a general opinion, but sometimes it happens. And on top of that, you talk about stature. Yeah, of course. Honored. And it's not easy to have your own stature during your lifetime, even before that. And close friends of mine, they always laugh at me. So, did you know, only statue for a live person in North Korea, not in South Korea. So, sometimes I feel so embarrassing, but I try to take it, all the Korean people who are so proud of me, and they are happy for me. That is the way I try to accept. And on top of everything, most kind of inspiring thing and make me happy is most of the Korean kids, whenever they think about the space, whenever they watch TV, whenever they try to do a space YouTube, they always watch a Russian, American, or somebody who speaks different language. But when I was in space, I talk about Newton's law and geometry in Korean with a similar face to them, so they feel more closer. And they could have hoped, maybe I can do it in the future. When they always watch white Caucasian people or some kind of different like people, and they feel like maybe it's not Koreans, maybe we cannot do that. So that part is a huge thing I can take. And I don't think it's because I'm skillful, I'm smart, but because I have a huge love to take that seat. So it was really incredible feeling. And a lot of my friends, most of all, right after my flight, and every single daily newspaper covered my face. And then my friends come to me and say, it's the first time in Korea couple page has an engineer, not a politician, not a celebrity. So I feel so happy to have my engineers in the couple page of the daily newspaper. So at that time, I don't feel like I'm Korean. I feel like I'm representing all engineers in Korea. So that makes me feel so happy.
Was a spark of your imagination and
the willing to go to space someday?
Yes, yes. Definitely. I would be a liar if I didn't admit to that. And especially the Star Trek. I was a big Star Trek fan growing up. As you can probably tell, I was like, to space. But the reason why I had that Star Trek uniform, and I love it, because Shannon is next to me, and we went into a whole deal about it, being allowed to bring it to space. So Shannon is what made it happen in the end, and I was allowed to take it, I'm allowed to take a picture with it. So thank you, Shannon. But it was sort of a coincidence he came, because in 1995, in January 1995, I was an exchange student in the United States. And so I had been a Star Trek fan all my childhood and adolescence up to that point. But I had been, in from the perspective of, Italy was where Star Trek was not that big. And from a person growing up in a little village, where I was probably the only Star Trek fan, I don't know, I had kilometers radius or something. So, very lonely, my passion for that. And then I found myself in the US, where of course Star Trek was big and was on TV every day, so it was huge. And then Voyager came out, and I think it was January 1995, so the first female captain of the Star Trek series. And I was there actually watching the day it debuted, not as it usually happened, an Italian translation years later. So I was excited about that. So 20 years later, I was in space. And so I wanted to celebrate that. And that's why I had specifically the Star Trek Voyager captain in the con.
I have another question for you, Shannon, because you did several EVAs. You trained to do EVAs?
Yes, I did train to do EVAs, but I was not actually slated to do an EVA while I was in space. We had one scheduled during my mission up there, and the other two American astronauts were the ones chosen to do that. And consequently, they didn't fly hardware for me to have the right equipment to do an EVA. Then we had a failure, and they had to do three EVAs, but I stayed inside and operated the robotic arm while they were outside the space station.
I was what we call the IAE, so the person who is responsible for suiting up these spacewalkers and doing on the air operation. And I mean, those were the most challenging days of my life. It's very tough. But Shannon had it a lot harder, because as soon as she closed, she watched them going around to make sure that everything was fine, she had to run to the robotic workstation and do very, very complex robotic operations. And then as soon as she was down, we were back to the air, making sure they got back inside. So I had the greatest admiration for that job. She had to do it, what, three times within like a week or something? So that's up to you.
Yeah. Almost running out of microphones. So speaking about robotics in space, imagine spaceflight, manned space missions, let's say human space mission, let's say to Mars, to the Moon, to Mars in 30 years time. How do you see the combination of robotics exploration with humans? On the ground and conducting EVAs and so on. Apart from, of course, robotic arms and so on. Anyone?
I think we need robots. Sometimes robots doing better than us. But also, in the same time, we always need humans because robots do everything and cannot do everything. And it's easy to think about your robot vacuum cleaner. It's really handy. And then they can do every single corner, because sometimes I forgot to do some corner, but robot never forget anything. But you cannot feel satisfied with the only robot that can clear, because there's some place you should have a human, and you should have some kind of feeling. And especially when we should have some urgent decision making, and they always working as programmed. But we can think, today maybe we don't have to do vacuum, and we can delay. But someday, even if it's not planned, but we should have a guest, so we should do kind of things. So those kind of combinations, we can think about that. And on top of that, some tedious job, and you don't have to waste energy over humans, so we shouldn't have a robot instead. And it's some kind of sensitive job, even if there is a robot, and some human should monitor it if it's okay or everything's going on. So I did not have a robot, but I hope robot can replace for all human because there's a lot of excitement and fun and heavy things we really want to take place. So I think communication will be better always.
Another issue is that you experienced the Russian hardware, the Soyuz, and you saw earlier that the landing of a Soyuz spacecraft is not so, let's say, gentle as was the space shuttle program, or even Apollo, for that matter. So I would like to hear from your experience about the landing, and let's start with you, because I know what happened.
Yeah, so we all experienced the same thing, and I did not have experience landing on the shuttle, so I can't really compare. But it is not a gentle landing. You are hitting the ground at a fairly reasonable velocity. It's a small car crash. That being said, they got a lot of mechanisms inside of the Soyuz to make it as soft as possible and not to hurt people. So you have got, although I do think it's not named properly, these engines, they call them soft landing rockets, that fire when they're about a meter off the ground to make the landing softer. We can argue whether or not they're softer landing rockets, not really soft landing rockets. The seat that you were in is molded to your body, and it acts much like a bicycle helmet does, and so it's a really hard landing. The material is designed to crush, and you have a shock absorber in your seat. So there's a lot of ways to make it as gentle as possible, but it is a small car crash on the ground.
Just backing off, the experience of through the atmosphere is just awesome. And I was in space with Scott Kelly, who, believe it or not, is still in space, is one of the two 1 year crew members who are there. And so we were talking, Terry and I, my NASA crew and myself, we were talking about the landing a few weeks out. And Scott was like, well, guys, I tell you one thing. If they ask me to do another 1 year flight after this one, that was the beginning. I don't know if you can say this still, but I would sign up for it just to be able to do the landing again because it's so cool, and it was. It's really exciting. So it's a few hours of total boredom because you undock from the space station, and then there's better than happening for a few hours. But then you have 40 minutes of the ride of your lifetime because you start. First of all, the Soyuz breaks up into three parts. You start getting these explosions, and you start seeing pieces of your spaceship and kind of fly across your window. And that's a good thing, because if you're not separated properly, then bad things happen. We will hear soon. and then you start getting the atmosphere, and you start feeling the G's, you start feeling heaviness for the first time, in my case, in 200 days, and that is similar in your case, for sure, so after a long time. And I remember feeling really, really, really heavy in my seat, and I looked at the G indicator, and it showed one. One is us right now, and I already felt so heavy, and I knew it was going to go up much higher. So I was getting mentally ready for that, and so you're getting pressed down further and further in your seat. We got up twice up to about 4.5 G's during Oriente, so you really felt crushed in your seat. But again, that is also good because then you can tighten your seat belts really nice, so that when you crash land. Then you're not gonna bounce off, so you really want to be tight. And then you start seeing all the flames from the plasma going past your window, and then if you manage, you can catch a glimpse outside, and you start seeing the Earth getting a lot closer than it has been for 7 months, which is weird, because you're used to being at a certain altitude, and all of a sudden everything was so close and close and close. And then you wait for the parachute to open, and that is probably actually harder than impacting the ground. And it's bigger. I thought it was a bigger shock. The parachute opened, and then you start shaking like you were in a washing machine during the centrifuge program as the capsule finds its balance. And then you surface smoothly, calm down, and you know, if everything goes right, as was in our case, you get in contact with the rescue forces and they start counting down for you, and it's like, you know, 500 meters, 400 meters, and you make sure that you're nice and tight, you have your elbows out, you have your tongue between your teeth and stuff like that. And then they say, you know, it's like 300, 200, 100, and then boom! In our case, it was a beautiful day in Kazakhstan. If you ever see pictures of the Soyuz landing and the step is green, it's probably us. It had been raining for a couple of weeks all the time, so the step was very uncharacteristically green and no wind on that day, so we just landed upright. And so it was actually a lot gentler than we didn't bounce, we didn't roll.
Yeah, my case is a little different from others, but first of all, some people ask me how harsh it is compared with the shuttle. But I've never been in shuttle before, so I can't tell. Some people ask me how harsh compared with the normal re-entry and boosted re-entry. I'm sorry, I've never had a normal re-entry before, so I can't compare. And some people ask me how harsh it is if you can compare with the car crash. And then, sorry, I've never had a car accident. But anyway, it's manageable. And I don't hurt at all. I don't have any other kind of problem because of the landing. And I survived. So I think it's okay enough to take it, and you really want to try it. But there's some kind of misunderstanding during my reentry because I have serious back pain right after the landing. And some people think maybe because of the latest reentry, maybe because you are in the service. I don't think so. Finally, my surgeon told me I grew up too much when I was in space because I'm a little younger than other astronauts, so I got an inch of my height in 2 hours. So crazy hard, painful back pain in space. It takes 3 or 4 days. And then finally I feel accustomed to live with 1 more inch higher and taller height. And then right after landing, all my inches gone away. So all my spine and nerves push each other. So I have a crazy, crazy hard, painful on my back, but it's not because of the ballistic reentry. So hopefully you don't misunderstand about my back pain. Anyway, we didn't have a good separation like Sam had, and we couldn't have such a rescue team during the landing because they don't know where we are, and we rolling and bouncing, so we are side by side. So I was in the bottom, and our commander, Yuri, was in the side, and then my dear friend Peggy was dangling on the ceiling, so it was really awkward moment. So Yuri untied himself by himself and opened the hatch. He crawled out, and he asked me to do. I crawled out, but we are so tired, so sorry to Peggy, but we cannot help her. But she was dangling over the ceiling for a minute, and then finally, local nomadic shepherd in Kazakhstan, they found us because they saw one big huge rock flying through the sky and landing on the ground, and they run to us and then they help us to get the baby get out of that. And it was really extremely unique experience for my life, not only as a human but also as an astronaut, because a lot of other Russian astronauts come to me and ask about the experience. So that was really incredible moment. But anyway, at the time I realized that how reliable machine they built and how safe machine they built, because even if we did have abnormal separation, we did have ballistic re-entry and everything, but nobody hurt, nobody even killed, nobody even kind of any scratch, we just get out of that. And of course I heard that our hatch is almost burnt because we are upside down and there's a lot of shaking and vibration and everything, but anyway, he was a survivor. I think it's really hard to design those kind of machines. Whatever happened, they saved people. And finally I realized that some senior astronauts who flew 10, 20 years ago, they always have a business re-entry. So it would be kind of normal re-entry at the time. So I'm grateful for everything, even if it's really hard.
measurement of safety of the crew, of the human participants in the space flights. Now we are at the beginning of a new space age, not only in terms of satellites, but also with human spacecrafts. We know about the Dragon, and we will hear about it later from Garrett from SpaceX, and there is going to be Orion, NASA, and the Boeing spacecraft as well, and other spacecraft for tourists, suborbital and at the end orbital. I would like to hear all of you your view of this interesting time that we are living in terms of access to space and the decision by space agencies to use the private sector as the provider of your lift to space.
Well, you're right. It is very interesting times that we have right now, and very exciting times as far as I'm concerned. Getting the commercial sector and the commercial companies involved is a very important step for the space agencies to do, in my opinion. The reason being is that space exploration is something that's not always easy, and it's something that takes a lot of time, and it's something that takes a lot of money. And so if governments concentrate on just one aspect of space, we won't be able to continue to explore, or we will, but it'll take much longer than we ever hoped to get anywhere. So having the commercial companies come in and start taking people to and from the space station certainly will allow NASA to concentrate on the Orion and our SLS rocket to go other places. And I think that's very important, not just for NASA in the US, but for all the space agencies around the world. But when you talk about safety, that is the crucial question, and it's a very difficult question, certainly from NASA's history and Russia's history. Spaceflight is very difficult, and there are always problems, and it's usually problems that you don't imagine. And so how do we work with the commercial companies to be able to imagine everything to make spaceflight as safe as possible? And that is just a difficult process that we're going to have to work through the companies on our own and the companies with NASA and other organizations who have a different history than they have.
I agree, and overall, just from a feeling perspective, I think it's really exciting. There's so much interest from private companies to get into the space business to expand access to space. And so it's definitely an interesting time to be in this business, and I'm really looking forward to multiplication of possibilities and opportunities, also not only for professional instruments, but also for people just want to go to space for their pleasure.
As a citizen of a small country, I kind of feel like more welcome than before and more welcome than people, because a country like Korea, we don't have a continuous human spaceflight program because of our size of the country, and then we don't have a technology for the huge launch capability, not because we are stupid, but because we don't have the capability of the whole population. So I feel a little kind of sorry to Korean kids who will not have a chance to apply for an astronaut if government didn't start for the astronaut program again after my flight. But once the commercial sector comes up, and then we could have more opportunity to work together and get in there without any political issue, without any diplomatic issue, and without any citizenship issue, if we get out of the defense stuff. So hopefully we will have a more chance to collaboration and join there, and more than before. So I would love to contribute anything to work together internationally. And then as a normal person, I always feel like it's easier to go through the commercial sector between the countries. So hopefully that will be a huge chance for not only for Korea, but also other small countries who really, really want to join the space business.
I have another question regarding what we heard this morning from astronaut Adam. He said that all the time we see people in space just smiling because it's so much fun, and even though there is a lot of hard work to do in space, but I want to hear if you have some moments that you felt away from home or too much hours of work or the daily routine was something that they just want to have one day off and your own activities. Or it's just me and the space is just fun all the time. I don't know.
Well, it's kind of a combination. Space, it is fun, but we do work really, really hard. The ground tries to organize our day, so we have mostly a Monday through Friday work day with half a day on Saturday and Sunday mostly off. And so we do get some time off to rest up for the long days. Now, when I was there, it's a little bit different when Samantha was there. We were still completing the building of the space station, and our days were very, very long, and so we were very busy and short on sleep all the time. That's why I took advantage of the weekends to try and catch up on my sleep. But I was always happy all the time. I was very content to be in space. I loved what I was doing. We didn't really have a routine because every day we get a schedule and it would be something different. Some days we would do maintenance or some days we would do science or we would have failures and all of a sudden we're having to do EDAs. And so didn't get a chance to be bored by my activities up there. Separation from my family was, you're separated from your family, and you know that going in, but these days also, we're very fortunate that we actually have good connections with our families on the ground. We have email, we have a telephone that we can call. I would call my husband every day, and then once a week we'd have a video conference. So we got to see each other pretty often. So it wasn't an overwhelming hardship to be away.
Yeah, I agree. And we actually have a thing which is called the task list. And it's a list of tasks that the planning people on the ground were not able to put on the schedule because there's not as many hours in a day. But they really wouldn't mind if you were inclined to do that, right? Because then they would be off their base and they would be able to plan other things. And that, you know, you would think that as some of you want to have a time off, but actually a lot of time on the weekends, you actually go into the task list and start to pick up your 2 or 3, whatever that you can do, because, I mean, you're out there and you sort of feel like you're in charge of something really important, which is the space station. You know, it's kind of like a, I don't know, you know, I felt like I was in charge of this raw humanity. You know, I happened to be up there with a few other people and I'm like, yeah, and so, you know, I really felt like we were there to take care of this place. And so in a way, you draw your happiness and feeling happy up there also, like this feeling that you're properly taking care of this amazing place that is entrusted to you. So, you know, sometimes you're tired, but at the same time, you look forward to tomorrow because it's what you derive pleasure from.
In my case, it's a little different because my flight is only 10 days, and I stay only 9 days in space. And you know, the Korean culture, they always want to spend full of the time of the day. And space agency planned my experiment whole day and fully. It's all Russian crew and also Russian official told to the Korean people, please don't make that full thing because it is impossible. And maybe Soyeon doing all this, you will deserve a lot of action because they should do some rotating and they should have some rest. But my ministry didn't listen to them carefully because they really want to spend a whole 9 days full of that. But I couldn't complain because I know it's the only chance so far. And I know we don't have any other astronaut who is ready for next flight because it was one last chance. So even I feel grateful for that because they keep making me busy. But I cannot smile when I vomit because of the motion sickness because that is really uncomfortable. But most of the time, I feel so happy and fun, and I know it's a really privilege. It's a great chance for my life, for my nation. So that makes me really, really excited. And even if I feel crazy tired, but when I had a conference with the Korean TV station, I cannot make a set crazy because whole Korean nation watch me only for 5 minutes. But even if I'm tired, if I make a set face, they think, oh, space is not that good. So I don't want to make those kind of misunderstandings, so I did my best to smile. But on top of everything, I feel so free because I don't have my mom to wake me up. I don't have my boss to scold. I don't have my space agency president who always needs something to even when I had a TV conference with the Korean president, I smiled. And then all my friends asked me, how can you smile that much when you talk with your president? It's really the only time. And I told them, most of all, I can't see his face at all. Because it's the one way. And second, even if I made a huge mistake, his security, his secretary, they cannot come up. They should be there until I land. So I can say anything. If I meet him in the Blue House, everything is swim, and whenever I make a mistake, they should have a serious face to me, but I'm in his face. So emotionally, physically, everything is really free. So I did my best to enjoy it, and then my mom sometimes told me, did you miss me? But frankly, I left my mom for my high school because I was in boarding school. And I meet my mom and daddy every 6 months, almost every year. But at that time, my mom watched me every night on the TV show. So I told my mom, Mom, you watch me more than often than before. And she said, oh, you couldn't watch me. And I know, but I haven't missed that much because it's only 10 days. So it was not a big deal, actually.
Just want to ask one question to the audience. Who is under 18 years of age? Okay. And who wants to be mentally, but chronologically speaking, who from the students wants to be an astronaut? Okay, quite a lot. So my last question to each of you is, could you give one piece of advice, two pieces of advice of to the students about what it takes to be an astronaut? And we know that it's not the first generation of astronauts that were over test pilots and almost like Superman and so on. So your piece of advice to the next generation of space explorers?
I guess my advice is to recognize that those of us that are astronauts are extremely fortunate because, as you see here, a lot of people want to be astronauts and very few are chosen these days. Hopefully it'll be larger numbers in the future. So there's a lot of luck involved, but the important thing, I think, is to go through life doing what you love to do. And if you do what you love to do, then you will be very good at what you do and you will stand out. And that's what will make you noticed by the countries that are looking for astronauts. Now, if we get more commercial spaceflight in the private sector comes along, then that'll probably still make you stand out. So do what you love and be good at it.
Yes, I second that. And the one thing I would add is that typically most astronauts that I know are talented people, of course, but not necessarily really good at one thing. They're typically pretty good at a lot of things. That's the type of people that we typically look for in the space agencies. And so, if you're trying to build your curriculum to, you know, be a good candidate one day for an astronaut selection that might happen in Israel, for example, you probably be good if you can build up a little bit of experience and knowledge and expertise in diverse fields. Because A, you know, those skills are going to be useful when you become an astronaut, but B, you show people that you are interested in different things and that you want to challenge yourself in different areas and you're not afraid of learning new things all the time. Because really, you know, what we do as astronauts a lot of the time is we learn, you know, we are sort of lifelong students. So you need to show that you like and love to learn.
Yeah, I totally agree with all my friends what they said. And on top of that, as a Korean, we don't know when even Korean astronaut will come. Because when I was a teenager in Korea, we don't have even space agency. So I cannot dare to be an astronaut, to imagine to be an astronaut. But I just follow what I really want to do. And I just do what I really want to enjoy. And that helped me a lot. And I was so surprised when I became an astronaut because during my PhD, during my engineering school life, I always had a complex and stressful of my background because I'm not a person who has a deep kind of depth of the knowledge because I studied mechanical engineering undergrad, but I tried to go to art school when I was middle school. When I was primary school, I really wanted to be a journalist, so I didn't want to go to law school. And I applied to the design school, but I couldn't get an admission, so finally I went to the mechanical engineering department. And then I transferred to the biosystems department for my PhD. So I was more like a generalist than the deep kind of depth of the person. But all my friends who studied in same school, they are kind of professional in their field. So that was my complex. And when I'm thinking about my job after my PhD, that is also kind of a huge headache. But after becoming an astronaut, that my weakest part became the strongest part compared with the other candidates because I should do 18 different kinds of experiments and I should communicate with every single different scientist. But you know, the kind of usual person thing, engineers are all same, scientists are all same, but it's different because we think Air Force, Navy, Army, they are all military, but we are not. We are totally different animals. So engineering and scientists also, but I can communicate most of them because I just eat my food every single place. So that helped me a lot, so I really want to tell to the teenagers, and you don't know when the opportunity comes to you, but please do your best, whatever you do, and then opportunity will find you. But sometimes opportunity cannot find you, but you should have a patience to wait until that time. But not the patient to wait without doing anything, but the patient to wait until the time with training yourself as a person who is be ready, as a person who is kind of be responsible. I think that is the most important thing I believe.
First of all, thank you for the time and the opportunity to speak to you today. We just want to give you a small token of appreciation. This is Israel premiere, and this is for you. And you usually see our country from more than 400 kilometers, but this is from slightly lower altitude. Thank you. So this concludes our panel, and thank you very much.